Okay, we're going to look today at the inverted pyramid type of story, which is the most common type of structure you will see in newspaper reporting and across the journalistic world. It is considered a basic building block of journalism. It has its advantages, it has its disadvantages, but in order to write well and write clearly, you need to master this format. So let's take a look at the basic structure right now. You're familiar with this from last year. At the top of the inverted pyramid, you have the most important details. Now, sometimes that can be who and what or where or when or why. Typically, it's not all of the answers to those questions. You have to figure out, using news values, what the most important information is. Don't try and cram everything into that first sentence or two, just the crucial information. And then we have less important information after that, and it continues down in order of importance till at the end we have the least important information. Short paragraphs and sentences, you can tell just by looking at an inverted pyramid story that in fact is what it is just by looking at it. And you'll notice that it's very easy for the editor to cut because he or she simply has to cut from the bottom of the story. The advantages, it's very easy for the reader to get the information quickly. It's easy to understand. It's written in an easy to understand manner. It helps to develop story sense on the part of the journalist. You can't write an inverted pyramid story unless you know how to impart information in a journalistic fashion and how to understand what the most important parts of a story are. So it helps to develop your skills as a journalist. Once you've got the hang of it, you can write these types of stories quite quickly. And as I mentioned before, they're very easily edited. The editor simply has to cut from the bottom. So it's not as time-consuming a process as another type of format might be. Some of the disadvantages, and they are clear, is that it can feel formulaic. Once you've read a few inverted pyramid type stories, they tend to all sound the same, even if the facts are quite different. In that respect, there's very little room for creativity, and the story doesn't have a typical beginning, middle, or end. And our brains are wired to enjoy stories and to follow stories that have a narrative structure with a beginning, middle, or end. And that narrative structure typically is absent in an inverted pyramid story. They can be boring. A story that doesn't have a beginning, middle, or end does not tend to contain drama. You tend not to have people emotionally invested in the story when you are basically giving them facts as quickly and efficiently as possible. So let's look now at an example of this type of writing. You don't have to look very far. Typically, dozens of stories every day in different newspapers are written in this style. In this case, we are looking at the Toronto Star, and it is a story about two men who are wanted in Scarborough in regards to a car robbery and stabbing. So let's take a look at the lead. Before we do that, you can tell just by looking at this story that it's an inverted pyramid story. Each sentence is its own paragraph. The sentences are relatively short. And the first sentence contains the key information. Police have asked for the public's assistance in finding two suspects wanted in a stabbing and robbery early Friday morning in Scarborough. Police say that around 3:30 a.m. near Lawrence Avenue Road East and Rouge Hills Drive, a man and a woman sitting in a parked vehicle were approached by two unknown men. And the story goes on from there to describe what happened in the robbery. And then after that, we get to the descriptions of the suspects. Two suspects. One is white, about 27, 5'8". Second one is white, about 6'2", 185 pounds to 200 pounds. And finally, the very last thing is the number to call if you have any information. So the reporter in this case, rightfully so, has decided that the least important thing in this story is the actual numbers for people to call if they know anything. But before that, you've got to get to the point and say why police are looking for these two people and what they allegedly did. All right, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 paragraphs. Looks to be about 400 words, maybe even 300. And the essentials of the story have been successfully given to the reader. So what we're looking at now is a fictional story. And this particular story is written without the organizational inverted pyramid format. The facts are just simply presented willy-nilly with no rhyme or reason. And what results is something that's confusing and which really backs into the story. So you'll see here in the Mueller News, the headline, an accident occurs. Okay, that's true, but it really doesn't tell me anything. It doesn't tell the reader anything. And let's take a look at the collection of facts here. And this collection of facts is from an exercise designed by Ken Blake, who is a journalism professor at Middle Tennessee State University. An accident occurred. It happened yesterday. Today is Tuesday. The accident was a car accident. It happened in Hamilton, where Barton Street and Jones Road intersect. One person was killed. That person is John Frazier. He was 20 years old and lived in East Hamilton. He was driving east. I've obviously changed some of the locations here to more reflect where we live, not Tennessee. He was driving east on Barton Street at about 5 p.m. He lost control of the car. It was raining. The road was slick. He was also driving about 20 kilometers over the speed limit. He was the only one in the car. The impact crushed the whole front of the car. Frazier was thrown through the car's windshield. He wasn't wearing a seatbelt. He was killed instantly. So you can see here, very, very frustrating to read. The most important fact in the story, the fact that this 20-year-old man was killed, is not even mentioned until the end of the story. So this is what can happen when you do not organize the story according to news values. You simply have a collection of facts that really don't have any rhyme or reason, and that will confuse the reader or make the reader just stop looking at the story. So let's take a look now at a story, the same story, the same collection of facts that is organized in an inverted pyramid style. Right away, I've improved the headline as well. Man dies in Barton Street crash, much more informative than accident occurred, which was our previous headline. Let's take a look now. A Hamilton man died Monday afternoon when his car spun out of control on Barton Street, crashed into a utility pole, and threw him through the windshield. So right there, if I stop reading as the reader, I have the gist of the story. I know the main facts just from the first sentence. And a sentence like that, like we have here, a Hamilton man died, ending with him being thrown through the windshield. A lead like that is called a summary lead, in which you summarize the key aspects of the story. So the reader gets the most important facts very quickly. Then we give the name of the man. The man, 20-year-old John Frazier of East Hamilton, lost control of his vehicle around 5 p.m. We save the man's name for the second sentence, the second paragraph, because he is not a well-known personality. If it was a much more prominent individual, we may put the name in the lead. For example, if this was a celebrity, you would probably put the celebrity's name in the lead. But in this case, no one knows, or very few people know, of this particular John Frazier, so we save his name for the second paragraph. It's significant. You just don't want to puzzle the reader in the first sentence. Then we say, police say he was driving 20 kilometers over the speed limit, skidding on the wet pavement. The car struck a utility pole at Jones Road. The impact threw Frazier through the windshield and onto the pavement some 6 meters away. Frazier, who was not wearing his seatbelt, died instantly. So four or five sentences, key facts of the case are organized in a very easy to understand, simple fashion. And you also see how the addition of a picture can really add drama to the story. By the way, I've taken this picture from a stock photo website that provides those types of things for free. You should not get in the habit of grabbing material from the internet and posting it without providing attribution or making sure that it is open source stuff that you're using. So that's an example of how to organize a series of facts into a inverted pyramid style. So to wrap up, let's review once again the structure of the inverted pyramid story. It begins with a summary lead, summarizing the key details, roughly 18 to 25 words, and only the key details, not everything. Don't try and cram all the facts into the lead. You've only got about 25 words. Sum everything up, and that is just the key crucial details. Then, in short paragraphs, you give the facts in descending order of importance. So more important to less important, and that is so that when the editor gets to the end of the story, if he needs to cut or she needs to cut, they can just simply cut from the bottom. It also is designed to make it easier for the reader to understand the story and get the key facts that they need. That's it for the inverted pyramid. If you have any questions, don't forget, you can email me at any time.